Good evening, everyone. I have the honor of introducing our first and one of our most beloved speakers. Lieutenant Colonel Alan B. West is a Christian constitutional conservative, combat veteran, and former member of the U.S. Congress. Alan West was born and raised in Atlanta, Georgia, in the same neighborhood where Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was once preached. West holds his bachelor's degree from the University of Tennessee, Knoxville, and two masters, one from Kansas State University and the other from U.S. Army Command and General Staff Officers College. West was commissioned through ROTC at the University of Tennessee as a second lieutenant on July 31st, 1982. He was assigned to the 1st Infantry Division, where he commanded Bravo Battery, 6th Field Artillery Regiment, and was Battalion Task Force Fire Support Officer for 2nd Battalion, 16th Infantry Regiment. While with the 1st Infantry Division, he participated in Operations Desert Shield and Operation Desert Storm. In November of 2010, Alan was honored to continue his oath of service to his country when he was elected to the U.S. Congress, representing Florida's 22nd District. I heard Alan speak for the first time last year at the National Conservative Student Conference, and I am so thrilled for all of you to hear him tonight. Please join me in my excitement in welcoming Alan West.
I have a second question. I'm sorry for my tone. Previously, I was just frustrated.
That's okay. I have two daughters. They talk to me like that often.
Thank you. My question
but
is...
But I cut them off with their allowance, though.
Well, you don't have that ability here.
I know.
My question is about national security, because I do feel like the KKK and white nationalists are threats to black individuals in the United States. There have been multiple shootings recently within the last 10 years, and there have been an increase of violence against black people. And I wanted to know if you think that that's a national security issue and how you would address that.
Yeah, I think it's a national security issue right here in the south side of Chicago, where you have a combat zone going on and Rahm Emanuel and everyone just seems to not care, or as well as in Baltimore or other places. And that's black on black crime. That's not KKK or whatever.
But white on black crime? I'm sorry, but that's what I was asking.
Oh, okay. Well, then, have you ever heard of Margaret Sanger?
You can't just give one example.
Well, Margaret Sanger and the organization that she founded, since 1973, almost 17 million unborn black babies have been murdered by that organization. I think that's something that we should really be concerned about. The fact that the United States government gives $568.7 million to an organization that was founded by a white supremacist, a racist, a person that spoke at Klan rallies, that referred to blacks as undesirables and weeds, I would join forces with you in a heartbeat to say that we need to cut off funding to an organization like that called Planned Parenthood. That 50, well, I don't think we give taxpayer money to the Ku Klux Klan. Well, they have. The FBI goes after white supremacist organizations. But then I would ask you, why is it that nobody goes after Antifa? I mean, I think Antifa is also a domestic terrorist organization. I mean, look at what they have done at certain colleges and universities to prevent people from going out there and freely speaking. So let's call a ball and a strike a strike. And so there are many organizations out there that we need to be targeting. But I will tell you, first and foremost, we shouldn't give $568.7 million to an organization like that. And if you do some research, I think between 50 to 55% of Planned Parenthood clinics are in black communities. That's a travesty.
And that, young people, is how you barbecue progressive socialist dummy butt. What a pleasure and an honor to be here with you all to kick this off. And thank you so much, Patrick and Yaf, for bringing me back out here to Santa Barbara, where I have had the pleasure and honor of having both of my daughters be out here and go up to the Reagan Ranch. And when I think about this moment that we have right now, First and foremost, I want all of the grown-ups, all the adults, all the parents to stand up and be recognized by these young people. Come on, come on, old heads, get up. Come on, get up. What I want you to understand is a verse out of the Bible. Okay, you can sit down now. You had your moment. What I want you to understand is a verse from the Bible. It's Proverbs 22 and 6. And Proverbs 22, 6 says, train up a child in the way that they should go, so that when they grow old, they shall not depart from it. The responsibility that we have in being here with these young people is much the same as when you run a relay race. And we are about to pass the baton. And if you know about running a relay race, you have an exchange zone. And you must pass the baton in the exchange zone. If you pass the baton too early, you're disqualified. If you pass the baton outside of the exchange zone, you're disqualified. And if you drop the baton, and it's an embarrassing moment, and you're disqualified. Our responsibility right now is to pass the baton, the torch of liberty and freedom, to these young people, this next generation. And when I look at what is happening in the United States of America, and I had the opportunity to sit and chat with a young lady that flew in with me today. She lives also in the Dallas area, and she goes to a high school there. And a couple of weekends ago in Dallas, we had this Drag Your Kids to Pride event where they actually opened up a men's gay bar and they brought children in, underage children, for a drag queen show. Now, this young lady that I was speaking to is fighting to get the Pledge of Allegiance said at her high school. This is where we are in the United States of America, where we are literally exposing our kids to behaviors that is not consistent with our principles and values, but yet the principles and values that are consistent with this longest running constitutional republic that the world has ever known, we're fighting to preserve them. And one of the things that I'm so honored to do is to get the opportunity to go and fight for these young people in high schools and college campuses. Because as conservatives, we must go on offense. We have to stop reacting. We have to stop being on defense. We have to understand that in America today, this is not a Republican and Democrat thing anymore. This is the seminal conflagration between two different philosophies of governance. That is constitutional conservatism, which, if you read and you understand John Locke, Second Treatise of Government, classical liberalism, natural rights theory, that's the basis of constitutional conservatism. And that's who Thomas Jefferson quoted in the Declaration of Independence when he talked about the laws of nature and nature's God. Because John Locke set forth these United States of America when he came up with the premise that your life, your liberty, your property, those are rights that are endowed to you from a creator. Those are naturally rights that come to you from your creator. It's not about a king, a queen, a duke, a duchess, a prince, or a princess. That is the relationship that you have. And it was codified in our Declaration of Independence when he talked about the laws of nature and nature's God. Now, the opposing philosophy of governance in America right now is progressivism, socialism, Marxism, communism, statism, whatever you want to call it. But what defines us as who we are as conservatives is that we believe that the individual is a supreme and sovereign entity in these United States of America. That the individual is sovereign because their rights come from a sovereign God, the Creator God, your life, your liberty, your pursuit of happiness. You are sovereign over the institution of government. But we are facing against a philosophy of governance that believes that the institution of government is sovereign over you and your rights, your freedoms, and your liberties. That they don't believe in the equality of opportunity that allows a kid born on February the 7th of 1961 in a blacks-only hospital to stand here before you today. A retired Lieutenant Colonel from the United States Army, a former member of the United States House of Representatives, the former chairman of the largest state Republican Party in the United States of America, and even a gubernatorial candidate in that exact same state. That's what conservatives believe in. That's what we have to pass on to you. Because I'm going to tell you something very honestly. There ain't a whole lot of permanent tan faces here. But I want to tell you little white kids something. Not nan one of y'all oppresses me. I want you to understand that. Because of your skin color, that does not define you as being an oppressor. And because of my skin color, that does not define me as being oppressed. Every single one of us live in the greatest nation that the world has ever known, and we can choose to be victors and not be victims. That's what conservatism is. Now, let's get to the crux of the matter. You know, the kid that came up here and said he was in the Air Force, I couldn't make it into the Air Force. They got this IQ test. You got to be really smart to get into the Air Force. And so I went to the Army, and the IQ test for the Army was pretty simple, especially if you want to be a paratrooper. You know, they show you a red light, and they ask you, what does a red light mean? Stop. They show you a green light, and they say, what does the green light mean? I can go. Son, you ready to be a United States Army paratrooper? And so one of the things that I learned as a young officer, as a young paratrooper, one of the things that they taught me was that you write it down. If you want to be prepared to go up and do what you just saw me do, or you saw Dinesh D'Souza do, or you saw Liz Wheeler do, you got to study. As it says in the Bible, train up your mind. My people suffer for lack of knowledge. That's what you have to do. It talks about in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 18, about the full armor of God. It starts with you right here. Every single one of you, by the time you leave this seminar, this weekend that you have, you need to have your 3x5 cards. And your 3x5 cards need to be the notations of all of the different things that you're going to be learning, because you've got to be able to quickly refer back to it. And so I'm going to start with my second 3x5 card, because my second 3x5 card breaks down the difference between constitutional conservatism and progressive socialism. That's why you have to be ready to offer an answer at any time. See, when you talk about constitutional conservatism, the very first thing is our Judeo-Christian faith heritage. America is unlike any other nation because our Judeo-Christian faith heritage defines who we are. I did not say religion. I said our faith heritage, because our faith heritage gives us those inalienable rights. If you don't have the Judeo-Christian God, then you don't have life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And when you look at what the left is trying to do in the United States of America, the secular humanists, which is what they are, they're trying to undermine the omniscience and the omnipotence of the Creator God. God couldn't get Adam and Eve right. And I'm glad I'm not taking biology with some of you guys, because I think there are, what, 62 genders now? I would certainly fail biology now, sir. But see, God couldn't get that, the man and male and female thing. God couldn't even get the marriage thing right. We can do that. You can decide what your gender is. God couldn't even get the weather right. I remember when I was in Congress and I was asked, well, Congressman West, do you believe in global warming and climate change? I said, yeah, I believe in climate change. It's winter, spring, summer, and fall. Okay? No, that's not what we're talking about, because what they're talking about is man-made. What they're talking about is them controlling. And what you have to understand is that to undermine our Judeo-Christian faith heritage, the left wants to establish their own religion, much the same as King Henry VIII did when he wanted a divorce, and the Catholic Church said no. So what did King Henry VIII do? He created his own church. The real essence of separation of church and state has nothing to do with us not being able to pray in schools. It has everything to do with not having a head of state, which is also the head of church, because your very first liberty that you have in the Constitution of the United States of America is the freedom of religion and the free exercise thereof. But what we find now, if you don't bow down and worship and pray to the religion of the left, then you would be persecuted and you would be prosecuted. Who would have ever thought that the very first thing the government would try to shut down in March of 2020 were churches? Not Walmart, not Mickey D's, not abortion clinics, but churches. That's because the very first part of constitutional conservatism is our Judeo-Christian faith heritage. The second thing is the strength of our families. When I was born in 1961, even though I was born in a blacks-only church, the two-parent household in the black community was between 75 and 77%. What is it today? 24%. Where did that come from? The policies of a progressive socialist president, Lyndon Baines Johnson, the Great Society, where he said that a woman that has a child out of wedlock will get a check from the government, making victims. And she will continue to get a check from the government, no matter how many children she is having out of wedlock, except there's a caveat. There can no longer be a working man in the home. And you look and see what is happening in our inner cities all across the United States of America today. How many kids in the United States of America this past weekend had no father for Father's Day because of the government coming in and undermining that strong constitutional conservative principle of families? The next thing that is part of our principles as constitutional conservatives is a quality education. We do not need cultural Marxism. We do not need indoctrination happening in our schools. What our schools are supposed to be doing is teaching you to be productive members of society, training up your mind so you can go out and understand what you can do to have a prosperous life. But instead, they're trying to indoctrinate you. There is a war on each and every one of you, our children in the United States of America, and parents, grandparents, adults. We have got to stand and fight for our children in this day and age. When we hear about what is happening in our schools, and thank God, the one good thing about COVID was that kids had to be at home and the parents had to be at home, and parents finally saw the garbage that their kids were being indoctrinated with. Not a quality education, but an unqualified indoctrination. And that's why I tell people the most important elected position in the United States of America is school board. Not president, it's not senator, it's not governor, it's school board. Because that's how we affect the future generations. That's how we make sure that you become the leaders now and the leaders for the future. Math, science, civics, history, those are the crux, those are the foundations that we need to be teaching to each and every one of you. And we need to listen to you. When you come home and you tell us, or when you tell Yaf, here's a problem that I have in my high school, such as in Garland High School. I live in Garland, Texas. And when they told the Yaf chapter that wanted to have an organization, they couldn't have it. You could have all other kind of different clubs, but they couldn't have the Yaf chapter. Well, guess what the old colonel did? The old colonel went to social media. The old colonel stood up and spoke up, and within 2 weeks, they had the Yaf chapter at Garland High School. That's what we must do. I love Yaf because they send us, the warriors, to go in and fight for you on these college and university campuses. Maybe some of y'all saw what happened at the University of Buffalo just recently with me being there. But the thing is that we exposed what was happening there. When these young black kids come out and start talking about Black Lives Matter, my simple question to them, which Black Lives Matter? Because the black lives are being killed every weekend in Chicago or Detroit. I don't hear about that. The black lives are being murdered, unborn, in the womb. Now we're over 20 million. I don't hear about that. The black lives are being relegated to failed public schools in the inner city. I don't hear about that. That's what we have to do. It's to challenge them wisely and challenge them aggressively. And when they call your name, you're winning the debate. Too often when they call us a name, we get reticent, we get recalcitrant, we go back on our heels because nobody wants to get called a name. Well, let me tell you something. Either you choose to believe in the flag that you took a pledge of allegiance to right now, and you stand up for these principles and values, or you just cower away in your home, and you make sure that I don't want to be called a bad name. Uncle Tom, sellout, Oreo, house N-word, white man's porch monkey. That was pretty inventive, white man's porch monkey. I'll give it to him on that one. But do you think that a guy that used to jump out of airplanes in the middle of the night at 800 feet with 250 pounds of gear and been in three combat zones will really care if you call him a name? No. Because what you just did was you let me know that I have the upper hand, that I have the initiative. And I want you to understand that, young people. When they call you a name, you don't back down. When they call you a name, you get more aggressive and you continue to go at them because you have trained up your mind to win the debate that you're in. And that's what a quality education gives you. And that's why you're here with YAF right now, to get armored up, to be able to go out there on this ideological battlefield in your high schools, in your colleges, because you're fighting against your peers. You're fighting against teachers. You're fighting against professors. You may be fighting against some other parents. And you're fighting against an administration. But this organization and this old colonel is going to wrap our arms around you, and we're going to be there for you. Individual responsibility is another thing. If you really want to get a big whipping from my mommy and daddy, say it wasn't your fault. Blame somebody else. Maybe my mommy and daddy should talk to the president right now, because he's really good at blaming everybody else. But the bottom line is that America sees the individual. We don't see the collective. We don't see you as just a number. And we want you to be responsible. We want you to be accountable. We want you to go out there and try. The motto of the British Special Air Services, the SAS, is this: who dares wins. Life is not about a participation trophy. And adults, we messed up. We thought that if we gave our kids a little plastic trinket, that would help to inspire them or help their self-esteem, instead of pulling them off to the side and saying, let me help you so that you can get in that game. Let me help you so that you can do a little bit better. We've got to stop making our young people believe that they're not responsible for their actions. And I got to tell you something that concerns me, young people. The amount of suicides I see out there. The fact that we are losing so many of you to this fentanyl. The fact that people are going on social media and ordering up these drugs and it ends up killing them. That's why I'm challenging you, each and every one of you right now. If you do not have a battle buddy, because we are in a fight, you've got to have someone that keeps you sharp, keeps you straight, keeps you on the straight and narrow. As it says in Proverbs, iron sharpens iron. No soldier goes into battle and he doesn't have a battle buddy. So this weekend, look to see who could be your new battle buddy that will be with you and carry you not just through these few days, but maybe over the next few years. Our free market economic system is part of who we are. We have built the greatest nation that the world has ever known. I want you to think about something. I've been to 13 different countries, a little more, and three different combat zones. Nothing beats the land of the all-night 7-Eleven, Denny's, and Waffle House. Okay? I couldn't get no waffles at 1 o'clock in the morning in Italy or Korea. Certainly couldn't get it in Kandahar, Afghanistan. But I want you to realize what has been done in this country in 246 short years is a miracle. It's remarkable. Because of our constitutional conservative principles and values, especially our free market economic principles and values. Because we believe in you. We believe in your innovation. We believe in your ingenuity. We believe in your drive and your determination. Who would have ever thought in the United States of America when we would see a time when our government would pay people to stay at home and not work? Because in America, we believe in the economic empowerment of the individual, not the economic enslavement of the individual. Who would have ever believed in the United States of America that a little girl would go out and put up a lemonade stand and police would come by and shut down her lemonade stand because she had violated some regulations. How do you inspire free market entrepreneurship in a young lady like that? My ideological mentor is a guy by the name of Booker T. Washington. Maybe some of y'all have heard of Booker T. Washington. If you have not read his autobiography, Up From Slavery, you need to read his autobiography. You want to talk about a person that could have been a victim but decided to be a victor? He put everything into education. He is the father of black conservatism. He is one of the greatest conservative minds that this country has ever produced. And when he established Tuskegee Normal Industrial Institute, his principles were education, entrepreneurship, and self-reliance. The only black institution of higher learning in the South for recently freed slaves. Not only did they get a book education, they made their own bricks to build their own buildings for the school. They learned the wood shop so that they could build their own desks. That's free market entrepreneurship. And even in the darkest days of the United States of America for the black community, you saw small businesses and entrepreneurship, Negro Business League, all of these things. We got to get back to that. Because if not, socialism as an economic model will always fail. Don't believe me? One of the most prosperous nations in the Western Hemisphere once upon a time ago was Venezuela. More oil and gas reserves than even Saudi Arabia. But when Hugo Chavez came in, well, the rest of it is history. Because socialists believe in nationalizing economic production. They don't believe in you being able to go out and establish a business and run it yourselves. But that's who we are. The last aspect of constitutional conservatism is that we believe in our strong national security. And I gotta tell you, how many Texans we got out there? Man, they live streaming this, and that's all y'all got? I'm gonna give you a second chance. How many Texans we got out there? All right, that's a little better. But look at what is happening in the border of Texas. We are not even protecting our own national sovereignty. And in the Constitution of the United States of America, in Article 4, Section 4, it's called the Guarantee Clause. Two things that the federal government is supposed to guarantee to every state in the union. Number one, a Republican form of government. Not Republican Party, Republican form of government, because America is a constitutional republic. If any of y'all ever come up to me and say America is a democracy, I will hurt you. The second thing is the federal government is supposed to make sure that every state in the union is protected from invasion. Millions are coming across the border into the United States of America legally. We're a very benevolent society, very benevolent people. But we want you to knock on the front door. Because what we see happening now is that we have a drug, a sex, and a human trafficking crisis in the United States of America, which is affecting your generation right now. And if we don't correct it, it will affect your generation into the future. Our Judeo-Christian faith heritage, our strong families, the quality of education, individual responsibility, our free market economic system, and our national security, that is the foundation and the cornerstone of constitutional conservatism. And real quickly, what does the other side believe in? Wealth redistribution. What do they believe in? Nationalizing economic production. What do they believe in? Creating and expanding a welfare nanny state. What do they believe in? Social egalitarianism, saying that everybody is equal. What do they believe in? Secular humanism. Nothing that the left in America believes in is in congruence with the founding and the foundation of the United States of America. We got a window of opportunity, team, in these next few years to preserve the last best hope for mankind. When I think about this man that you're going to go up there and see his ranch, Ronald Reagan, the impact that he had on my life was that he told me it ain't about black, white, Hispanic, Asian, whatever. It's about one word. It's American. It's about standing up for America. When we went to Desert Shield, Desert Storm, we had all new battle equipment because of Ronald Reagan. He invested in our national security, and he gave us those immortal words, peace through strength. America is not standing strong right now. But when I look out at your faces, I know that the better days of this great nation are ahead of us. And I will do my part in passing that torch to each and every one of you. And I will do my part in going out there and fighting for you and with you to make sure that you have every single opportunity that I had in this incredible nation that I love. And that's why when folks say that America's a racist nation, that America's a not an exceptional nation, I'm just reminded of what my dad said to me. My dad, who was born in 1920 in the South, who went to fight for this country as a corporal in the United States Army when this country did not see him as equal to some other people. He said that there's no greater honor than to wear the uniform of the United States of America. And he challenged me to be the first officer in our family. And from that simple corporal from South Georgia, who had a son that was a Lance Corporal, United States Marine Corps, Vietnam, who had another son that was a lieutenant colonel, 3 combat tours of duty, who now has a grandson who's a lieutenant colonel with 3 combat tours of duty, who now, I have a son-in-law right now who's at Fort Jackson, South Carolina, going through Army basic training. The greatness of America is in each and every one of us. Our light makes America exceptional. We say, e pluribus unum. From the many of us, it comes one. The socialists don't believe that. The Marxists don't believe that. They have come out the closet and they are declaring who they are and what they believe in. And I say we fight. I say we meet them, we challenge them, and we say we're not going to surrender another inch of these United States of America. God bless you all and thank you. Thanks. Thank you. Thank you. All right. All right, sit down. Sit down.
Because all y'all want to hear is Michael Knowles. Michael Knowles. He wrote a book with no pages.
Hey, Michael. How you doing? All right, question and answer time, right?
So we do have time for some questions. So Matt is going to help out with the Q&A line. So feel free to come up to the mic. Just state your name, where you're from, and a brief question.
All right, not everybody run at the same time. All right, shoot, go. From Rome, Georgia.
Yes, sir.
All right.
I'm Henry Thornton, and I'm from Rome, Georgia. And I wanted to ask you, I actually wrote it down. So what do you think about the pullout in Afghanistan as a veteran?
The withdrawal from, and first and foremost, I spent 2.5 years in Afghanistan, in Kandahar province, southern Afghanistan, the hotbed, the home of the Taliban. That hurt my heart. And there were many of my friends that I had to talk out of committing suicide. That was the greatest strategic, operational, and tactical debacle in the history of the United States of America. Because we fought hard to get that enemy off the battlefield, the enemy that harbored the people that brought 9/11 to our shores, and we restored that enemy right back into power. And on top of that, we gave them billions of dollars of equipment and made them, I think, the 12th or 13th largest Air Force in the United States of America. So that hurt. It really did. And that's why you see what is happening today, because the enemies of America see us at a weak point, being Russia, China, North Korea, Iran, and Islamic jihadists.
And the Islamic jihadists, if you read intelligence reports, Al-Qaeda is making a comeback. ISIS is making a comeback. Haqqani Network, everybody. Afghanistan is once again a hotbed. People have asked me, what is the most memorable thing that you could think of in your entire time in the military? It's very easy. Seeing little girls go to school in Afghanistan. They did not have that opportunity until we showed up. And it breaks my heart knowing that that opportunity is gone. And they have gone right back. And that was a generation of girls that never knew the previous heinous, barbaric acts of the Taliban, like shooting Malala Yousafzai in the head for wanting an education, throwing acid on little girls going to school. So it hurts.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Hello, sir. My name is Nathan Thomas.
Yep.
I'm from Blythe, California.
Mm-hmm.
And you mentioned that your ideological mentor is Booker T. Washington.
Yeah.
And I was just wondering, what specific ideas or traits have you seen in Mr. Washington and applied to yourself?
A never quit philosophy. I mean, here is a guy that, like I said, was born into slavery. And when he became free, he only wanted one thing, that was an education. And he basically went from present day West Virginia all the way over to Hampton Roads area to Hampton Institute. And he was recognized because of his diligence and determination and his humility that they told him to go and establish the first institution of higher learning for blacks in the South. He didn't say, I can't do it. He didn't say, well, who's going to help me? He just took off and did it. And so when I look at what came out of Tuskegee Institute, George Washington Carver and all the agricultural experimentation, the Tuskegee Airmen, even the Commodores, some of y'all old heads, y'all remember the Commodores, right? They came out of Tuskegee, Alabama. But what I'm getting you to understand is that he didn't start out saying, who's going to give me some reparations? So I find it absolutely insidious that we got people running around here today talking about, I need reparations from slavery. What you needed to get off your butt and get out there and take advantage of the equality of opportunity that this country affords you. I am sick and tired of so many people falling for the line of being a victim. And so that is the example that he has set for me in my life, is that there is no need to be a victim.
Thank you, sir.
Yep. Up from Slavery is his autobiography. That should be on your reading list.
Hi there, Mr. West.
Hi, sir.
Hi. My name is Joshua Fowler. I'm from Santa Clarita, California. I was wondering, you said a lot about the importance of a quality education.
Yep.
And I just wanted to know if you had anything to say on the lines of public school versus homeschool education.
And let me tell you what I believe in. I believe in school choice. I believe that the people that make the best decision for their child is the parent. And I am so happy that the Supreme Court made the decision that they did about the Maine public school system, because, you know, the parent should be able to say, this is what I want my child to have. And the dollars of the parent should follow that child to wherever they decide for that child to go, which includes being in homeschooling. Now, the thing that we have to be very careful of is that all of a sudden, you know how government can get. We don't want them to go in and then start manipulating and saying that this is the type of curriculum that needs to be done, even in homeschooling. What do you see happening now? Now the government is talking about a national curriculum, nationalizing economic production, all type of production. That's part of the socialist economic model. So I think it is important that we challenge the left and the control that they have on the public school system. You know, the teachers' unions aren't standing up for kids. The teachers' unions are standing up for themselves. And what they have done to our children over the past couple of years is criminal. It really is. What they have done is setting our kids back. Look, even in the state of Texas, somewhere 45 or 46 in education in the United States of America, and we can't get school choice passed in Texas. I don't get it. School choice is the civil rights issue of this generation. And especially when you look at our inner cities, no one should be relegated to a failed education system. And we need to do better. And that's why we have you all out there to start carrying that mantle. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Hello, sir. Good evening. My name is Daniel Levy. I'm from Scottsdale, Arizona, and I'm the Air Force jock back. And so my question for you...
I know. You want a flight suit. You want, you know, the cool shades and everything.
My question for you is concerning the wokeness that we've seen in our military in the last couple of years, pushing critical race theory and those types of agendas. Do you think that this is going to take our military into a downward spiral to where it crashes, or do you think that the pendulum's going to swing back in the future and kick all that stuff out?
Look, you're looking at someone. I survived the 8 years of Bill Clinton being in office. It was not fun for us in the military. I mean, we had to buy our own toilet paper going into the barracks. We had to buy our own tools. Friends of mine that were in tank units had to use golf carts to go out and do tank tactics because the fuel. We couldn't afford the fuel. We couldn't afford the spare parts because so much money has been taken away from us. So we will be able to survive this. But this is what we have to understand. And you got to go back to the Obama administration. Barack Obama did an incredible job purging the senior level leadership in our United States military. He absolutely did. And if President Trump was sitting right here where Patrick is sitting, I would tell him that, sir, you made a mistake in not going back and fixing the senior level leadership of our United States military. That's what we have to start looking at. When people talk about the deep state, it's this bureaucratic administrative state. It's not just the people that are up in these major cabinet positions. It's 2, 3, 4, maybe 5 levels deep that we have to be concerned with. And so I don't know if some of y'all have seen this recent video that came out from the Navy about pronouns that are supposed to be used, or even at West Point, they've got this, teaching about, the cultural Marxism, white and black and all this stuff. How can you say to soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, because of your skin color, you're an oppressor, because of your skin color, you're oppressed, but yet we want you to go out and fight as a cohesive unit? That's dumb. And so what we got to do in 2024, look, roadkill will beat Joe Biden or Kamala Harris, okay? But roadkill has to go in there and make sure that we have the right constitutional conservatives, not just Republicans, but constitutional conservatives in these positions in our government, especially our military. We're going to be in a world of hurt because China, Russia, and all these people, they see this as a window of opportunity. China just launched its third aircraft carrier. About 10 years ago, China did not have an aircraft carrier. The means by which you project a nation's strength, and I know you're going to love me saying this, sir, it's through his navy. That goes all the way back to the Athenians. And so when we see China putting so much into their navy, just the same as Japan did, we need to be very concerned. We got the smallest naval force that we have ever had in the history of the United States of America right now, modern history.
Thank you.
Yep. Thank you, sir.
Hello, my name is Megan Richardson, and I live in Palm Springs, California. So my question is regarding the recent Supreme Court decision for school choice in Maine. And one of the three dissenting judges said that it threatens the separation of church and state. And I know that the left has really misconstrued what that means.
Totally.
And so I wanted to understand what you believe that the Founding Fathers actually meant by that statement.
Well, it's very simple. If you go back and you read Thomas Jefferson's letter to the Danbury Baptist Convention of Connecticut, what the concern was the schism between Baptists and Presbyterians. And what they wanted to make sure that those Presbyterians didn't get a whole bunch of power and exclude the Baptists. This was never about separating our Judeo-Christian faith heritage from the fabric of the United States of America. And if you really look, most of our founding fathers, they talked about that coordination between understanding the gospel and the principles of Christianity and education. So separation of church and state meant that we did not want to have a head of state that was head of the church. But when you look at this Coach Kennedy case that was up before the Supreme Court, Coach Kennedy did not go out there and say, y'all must come down and pray with me. He went out there by himself. He didn't get on a megaphone or anything like that, and he just knelt alone. He didn't say anything. And to say that that's a violation of separation of church and state, that's them trying to strip away from you your very first liberty, the freedom of religion and the free exercise thereof. So what ends up happening is that the public schools don't want any challenge. They don't want to see the loss of that money. They want that money to go where they have the
the impact and the influence. You know, we were talking at the table. I want every state to have a Hillsdale College. I want us to be able to say that, no, you don't have to go to these major land-grant universities. And I wish we had governors that would stand up and say, if this is the type of stuff, I'm sorry, I know mixed crowd here. If this is the type of stuff you want to teach on a college or university campus, you're not getting state taxpayer money. Dip into your endowment fund, but you're not getting state taxpayer money. That's what we have to start doing, is challenging the left. And we should not. I mean, we have professors at Texas and Texas A&M that said, we're going to continue to teach cultural Marxism, critical race theory on our campuses in Texas and Texas A&M. Well, the governor should have said, very well, here's your line item veto. You're not getting any state-supported fund from that. That's what we have to start doing. So that dissenting judge, I think it was Sotomayor, she ain't been right on any decision in quite some time.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, I'm Sarah Bates. And my question is, when we debate controversial topics with leftists, like you said, the abortion rate for black babies, like the number of dead
it's over
is
20
over
million.
20 million. Do you think it's better to have like a squad instead of just a battle buddy in something like that?
Well, it depends on how good you are. I mean, when I was in the Congressional Black Caucus, I mean, it was one of me and 41 of them. That was fair odds for me. Okay, so, but Sarah brings up a good point. The numbers that you need to have with you is based upon your experience and your understanding, your knowledge. You know, I don't have any problems going to Northwestern or Cornell or some of the other lovely places that Patrick has said. I was just tickled pink when all of these kids went crazy at the University of Buffalo because it was not a fair fight. But it's going to take a while for you to get to that point. But it's kind of like the apprenticeship that you're starting here right now. And that's why I'm saying you got to carry your 3x5 cards. And it has to be something that you go over and over and over again. That's what the military does. The military makes you do something over and over and over again. Why? Because when you get into a firefight, it has to be instinctive. You ain't got time to break out a book in a firefight. But that's what I want you to do. And let me congratulate you all on something. You all are light years past where I was being in high school. I mean, you are. And so I want to thank you for stepping up in this time, because you could be back looking at life with the Kardashians or playing on TikTok, or maybe some of y'all will play on TikTok later, but don't, because China is, you know, taking your personal information. But the level of experience that you have is based upon how many people you need to carry with you. A Special Forces A-team has how many people in it? Just 12. Now, when they first start out, they probably can't go out and do that. But through their experience and their training, they become that A-team and they can go out and do it. But you got to start with a battle buddy. And then you can have a battle squad. You can have a battle platoon. But it's got to start with you training your mind first and foremost.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
Hello, sir. My name is Esther Ischler. I'm from San Jose, California. And my question is, what tips would you have for someone who's interested in joining the Army? And also, if you have the time, what was your workout routine like? Sorry.
Well, I mean, you know, I'm 61, and I still get up 6 days out of the week, and I put in anywhere from 3.5 up to 5.5. If I feel real good, I'll push it out to 6 miles. A lot of push-ups, a lot of crunches. I don't go to the gym. And when the weather's nice, I hit the outdoor pool and get a lot of laps in, and so that's it. And so it's endurance muscle and strength. That's what the military is looking for, not the, you know, I'm going to put everything in the gym on a bar and try to push it out. Because, you know, when you're out there on a 20-mile hump and you've got, you know, 80 pounds on your back, you need to have endurance muscle, not just power muscle. And what I would tell you is that, just the same as my dad told me, there is no great honor than to wear the uniform of the United States of America. To have the title of soldier, sailor, airman, marine, and coast guard. And so there are so many people that are concerned about, well, you know, it's the Biden administration, maybe I shouldn't go in. The uniqueness of our military is that we don't take an oath to a political party. We don't take an oath to a person. We take an oath to this, the Constitution of the United States of America. And see, the Constitution of the United States of America is immutable. It's our rule of law. And if you believe in this, then be a soldier, sailor, airman, marine, or Coast Guardsman. And what I will tell you is that it takes a level of discipline, it takes a level of humility, and it takes a level of understanding that you may have to do what Abraham Lincoln said in the Gettysburg Address, be willing to make the last full measure of devotion. Memorial Day hits me hard because I'm remembering buddies that ain't here anymore. But you know what my responsibility is? To make sure that their loss of life shall not be in vain. So I hope that you will join our little fraternity and sorority of warriors for this great nation.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Hello, Colonel West.
Howdy.
Hey, my name is Colin Voges.
Yeah. You've been up here like three times.
Yeah,
man.
I have. It's been kind of fun.
Yeah.
So, as a combat veteran, you know more than any of us here that an enemy that is, or an opponent, the most committed is the one that is most likely to win. I personally believe that one of the biggest issues for us right now, that we that the live and let live idea that the conservatives have right now, is just not working. We're not fighting back. We're defending, we're standing our ground, but we're not fighting back.
Yeah.
I want to hear your thoughts on the fact that how has that failure affected us? What should we do to
Because you don't that? You don't win on defense. And you know, we should never have to defend the Constitution. The Constitution stands and speaks for itself. And I think it is time that we go on offense. Too often what we find on our side is that we bring a plastic spoon to a gunfight. Ain't gonna work out well. And we're always following them. We're always chasing them. We're always allowing them to set the narrative and the talking points. That's why another book, okay, one book that I told you all should be on your reading list is Up From Slavery by Booker T. Washington. The other book that has to be on your reading list is The Art of War by Sun Tzu. That teaches you how to outmaneuver your opponent because we're not doing that very well. And, you know, we need to have a predictive analysis of where the left is going, so that we can defeat them before they get there. Because what they believe in is a failure. I mean, Winston Churchill said that socialism is the creed of ignorance. So why should we allow ignorant people to defeat us? We shouldn't. They're stuck on stupid, okay? I mean, they really are. And that's why it's such a joy to go on these college and university campuses, because it's like, you got the plastic spoon and I got all the ammo. But it's gonna take the intestinal fortitude of you to step outside your comfort zone and to go on offense. Because what I say, they call you a name. There's not a single person in here that's a racist, but they're gonna call you a racist. There's not a single person in here that's a misogynist. They're gonna call you misogynist. They're gonna call you all of these different things. When Joe Biden gave his inaugural speech, it wasn't about unity, it was about conformity. Go back and read his speech. And it's about time that it says in Romans 12 and 2, Christians, you're not supposed to conform to the world. You're supposed to transform it through the will of the mind of Christ Jesus that's in you. So we've got to start transforming and stop conforming. And that means you got to go on offense.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. My pleasure.
Hello, Mr. Hello, Mr. West. My
Howdy.
Name is Lincoln
Mr. Gaffney. West is my dad. I'm just Alan.
Hello, Alan. My question is that many people who were against the war on terror claim that the Patriot Act, which was a major part of the war on terror, is a violation of civil liberties. How do you respond to that claim?
No, I agree wholeheartedly. As a matter of fact, when I was in Congress and the Patriot Act came up for its five-year renewal, I voted for the short-term extension. I think it was like 60 or 90 days because I wanted more time to study it. I was brand new up there in Congress. And I sent a letter over to Robert Mueller, who was the FBI director at the time. Of course, he didn't respond back. That did not sit very well with me. But when you peel the onion back and you look at the Patriot Act, it really was more of an infringement upon your individual liberties and rights than anything else. We got to get to the point where we target the adversary, the enemy, the problem, instead of looking at what government does. They just come in and throw a net, and they end up taking your individual rights and freedoms away from you, just like what we see happening in the Senate right now. Red flag laws or a violation of your second, your fourth, and your fifth constitutional amendments. If you don't know what I'm talking about, pull out your constitution and read and see. But yet some people are saying, we gotta do something. Well, doing something does not mean that you violate individuals' constitutional rights, freedoms, and liberties. So yes, when it came back up for the 5-year extension for the Patriot Act, I voted against it. Really did not sit well with the chairman of the House Permanent and Select Committee on Intelligence, Mike Rogers at the time. But when I laid out the reasons why I didn't support it, he just kind of said, okay, I got it. No emergency. No emergency suspends your constitutional rights. But you know what the danger was in this whole COVID episode? You told people it was okay to suspend your constitutional rights. Show me a time ever when we tell healthy people they can't come outside, when you can't go out on a paddleboard by yourself on the ocean, when a dad gets arrested for being at a playground with his daughter and nobody else. We're at a tipping point, and that's why you're here, and that's why YAF exists.
Thank you, Mr. Rice. Mm-hmm.
We have time for one more question.
Oh, this is going to be a doozy. I can just feel it.
Hello, sir. My name is Charlotte Peters, and I'm from Ventura County. So my question is that when you talk to a lot of people on the left, they will often make the claim that America was built on the backs of slavery. So therefore, standing up for America is racist, and you're supporting slavery. How would you respond to that?
Okay, show me a country that was not built on the backs of slaves. I mean, I can look at Egypt, I can go, and you know, even in Africa, there were black tribes that enslaved other blacks and they sold them to whites. And you know, we fought a war to eradicate this thing called slavery. And oh, by the way, there was only one political party that did not support 13th, 14th, or 15th Amendments. That's their party. And they have a president that said that no amendment to the Constitution is absolute, so maybe they want to take us back to slavery once again. And so I say, look at the example of a Booker T. Washington. Look at the example of Black Wall Street. Look at the example of Auburn Avenue. Look at all the multimillionaires you have here. So we can go back and talk about America was built on the backs of slavery. America was built on the backs of men that decided they wanted to have a place where individuals could be free and there would be equality of opportunity. Now, did we have to matriculate through some very difficult issues? Yes, but show me a nation that did not have those issues to go through as well. I'm telling you something. What I have happened in my life, there's not too many countries where that can happen. Born in a blacks-only hospital, and I'm standing before you here today, I've never been a slave, and I will not allow anyone to give me a slave mentality. But I want you to understand this. There are two ways that you enslave people. You work them for no pay, or you pay them for no work.
Thank you.
All right. Let me close on this. Back to the 3x5 cards. And there will be a test. I won't be here, but I'm sure there are going to be a test. Let me read you a quote, and this is one of those immutable quotes that I carry with me. The uncontested absurdities of today are the accepted slogans of tomorrow. They come to be accepted by degrees, by dint of constant pressure on one side and constant retreat on the other, until one day when they are suddenly declared to be the country's official ideology. That quote comes from the 1950s from a woman by the name of Ayn Rand. Where we are in America, the absurdities that have manifested itself today, this has been 50, 60, 70 years in the making. Because of constant pressure on one side and the constant retreat on our side. It's time for constitutional conservatives to do as William Barrett Travis did on the 5th of March, 1836, at a place called the Alamo. He took out his sword, he drew a line in the sand, and he said, "Who will stand with me?" 183 came across that line, to include Jim Bowie, who was relegated to a bed, but yet he had people pick his bed up and bring him across that line. The following morning, all 183 were killed. Their bodies were piled up, they were burned. But it was on April the 21st of 1836 that some 700 Texans went across a battlefield called San Jacinto and attacking a force of almost 1,500 to 1,600 of the Mexican army under Santa Anna. And they shouted, "Remember the Alamo." And in 18 minutes, from 4:30, I believe, in the afternoon to 4:48, the battle was over. This is a line in the sand moment. If you want to make sure that the absurdities that we see today do not continue on for your generation, and to put it in a biblical perspective, just remember what Isaiah said in chapter 24, verse 15, where he said, "Choose for yourselves today whom you shall serve. Being the gods of the Amorites or the gods from across the river," he said, "but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." And he called upon the children of Israel, the people of Israel, gathered before him to be a witness and testify to that. And they said, yes, they would. But when you turn over to the next book, Judges, in chapter 2, it said that the generation of Joshua and those some generations after us all perished. And the children of Israel bowed down to the Baals. One of the gods of the Baals, pagan god, was the god Moloch. Moloch was the god of child sacrifice. That's why I'm telling you, we've got to pass the torch to generation to generation to generation. We got to tell that story. Because if we don't, then these absurdities that we see will just manifest themselves in the future generations. But that's why you're here. Because you're going to make sure that the vision of Ronald Reagan, true constitutional conservatism, does not perish from this earth or from this nation, and that the government of the people, by the people, and for the people shall live on in perpetuity. God bless you all. Thank you.